This is the Ashmolean Museum. It's old. Of course, there are advantages to that, particularly if one of your interests is in the history of collections, the origins of museums. But quite frankly, for most of our visitors, that's not really what they want to hear about. There are ways. I mean, we were just talking just now about the use of personal stories to make something more accessible. You can, for example, very effectively tell the story of how Elias Ashmole may or may not have defrauded the widow of John Tredescant to acquire the original collection. He was certainly a very clever lawyer. That much is beyond dispute. Thank you. You can address it in that way, but essentially that's not really what most of our visitors are interested in. Frankly, the museum was beginning to show its age. It behaved increasingly like a research institute, much more than like a public museum. Admission was free. We had 380,000 visitors a year, which was not enough. The gallery displays were tired. Curators were prone to prepare their exhibitions as if they were scholarly papers intended for a scholarly audience, assuming knowledge which most of our visiting public did not possess. Many of the galleries, quite frankly, were used for storage. They just had far too much material in them, and they were overpowering for our visitors. It has been said, not entirely fairly, but with some truth, that we moved from the 19th century to the 21st century without visiting the 20th century. Okay, now 50 years ago, many museums in Britain were not unlike this. But the world was changing and we were in danger of being left behind. Not everyone welcomed the prospect of change in the museum, but public funding does demand public value for money. Now, this is a rather mundane justification for modernization. In the keynote address that Simon Molesworth gave us, he reminded us that access to cultural heritage is actually a human right. That makes it all the more important that such access is meaningful. A curator who does not write intelligibly for the general public actually obstructs them in the enjoyment of their cultural rights. So that's a pretty heavy charge, which we need to take seriously. Nevertheless, modernization was essential to protect our government funding. But change on this sort of scale required, change itself needs funding. Oxford University contributed, largely. But we still needed government help and much private philanthropic giving. We received many small donations from the general public, which is very gratifying and is evidence of widespread support. But you still need the big hitters. Some very large donations came without further conditions. But more often, big donors like to get involved. And they have clear ideas of their own about how things should be done. Now, there are many advantages to this. Some of our big donors had extensive experience and contacts achieved in work on other projects. But at the same time, as I say, they can have ideas which are sometimes difficult to accommodate with the curator's ideas of, frankly, truth. So, one of the things they're particularly fond of course, are big showy new buildings. Architecture is a great feature of what big donors like, and it's actually hugely important. This is an example of the sort of thing which we've achieved. But there is a danger. If you're too much preoccupied with grand spaces, that you may not be providing enough explanatory material. And certainly one of our donors was dramatically unsympathetic to explanatory panels. He was very much an arts for art's sake sort of man. He wanted the object to speak for itself without realizing that most of our audience didn't speak the language of the object. Okay. Now, I don't want to knock architecture. I'm actually a great supporter of it. And it's an interesting, in this particular case, many curators were alarmed about the number of double height galleries which were being produced, because they pointed out that most of our objects are rather small. And in fact, in this particular case, we were hugely mistaken, the curators. The architects got it right, because when the public came into the museum, they really responded to the space. They recognized that a huge effort had been made to make this a welcoming and pleasant experience for them to walk around. And that makes a huge difference. So I'm a great supporter of architecture, but as in all these things, you need a balance. You need a balance. Government funding is rather different from philanthropic giving. In Britain, this usually comes from the National Lottery, which contributes large sums to good causes, rightly expecting clear public benefit in the form of much better public experience for the widest possible audience. Reconciling the conflicting ambitions of the two types of funder, you can see we have a certain amount of explanatory panels here. We have VDUs and technical presentations, which again, some of our donors don't care for. And we have to balance the conflicting claims of our funders. This calls for endless meetings and an enormous amount of diplomacy. But even the new building could not begin until thousands of museum objects had been packed, computerized, and moved to safe storage to allow the demolition of much of the existing building. Now, demolition and rebuilding may not be necessary in every case, of course it's not. But it does illustrate vividly, and this is why I talk about it here, the extent of change required to the whole mentality of the museum. There's no getting away from it, that change on this scale is a hugely traumatic experience for everyone involved. We didn't kill anybody, but there were some difficult experiences. The scale of the transformation we were dealing with is clear from the aerial view. The pink represents the surviving portions of the original building, while the white shows the area of new construction. So effectively, we're talking about two-thirds of the museum being demolished and then rebuilt. This scale of change is not easy. But as I say, I emphasize it because it does illustrate the scale of change to the mindset which is required in any development. Even if you're not knocking down your building, if you're making significant transformations, you really need to think about the whole mentality of the museum. Now, nobody's ever doubted that the Ashmolean had great collections and an academic staff capable of producing cutting-edge scholarship. But there was a real need to improve the presentation and interpretation, to make both the knowledge of the curators and the collections themselves much more accessible to the widest public. Now, this requires improved display, and carefully drafted information panels. Text has to be clear and accurate and layered, so it's essential, so that the essential information occurs first and more detailed information is provided in subsequent paragraphs. But above all, the text has to be short. Now, being accessible, accurate, and brief is not easy. It doesn't come naturally to many curators who are used to writing books and academic papers, where there is almost no limit on the number of words. There's also a whole new mode of expression needs to be engaged. Curators, for example, I'll give you an example, curators are used to using shorthand in the sense that they talk about the 12th century and expect their readers to know what they mean. Most of our audience very often don't immediately know, though if they stop and work it all out, they get there. But it's a simple thing like that, and it's very difficult to persuade curators that that kind of shorthand, where they know what they're talking about, they know what they mean when they say the Renaissance, this, this, that. They know what they mean when they talk about Quattrocento. But of course, much of our audience don't. And those are the sorts of considerations which have to be taken into account. And if there's one thing a curator, like most authors, is touchy about, it's about their literary style. So you can foresee that there are going to be tense and difficult meetings. That's the nature of life. Now, the standing visitor, of course, absorbs much less information than the sitting reader. That's one of the reasons why it's important to keep our text short. Graphics can communicate very effectively, as can the new technologies. Audio guides and handheld devices and fixed monitors. There's one just on the extreme far side of the slide here. These can all help, particularly if they link into the museum database, which is something that we're trying to achieve for those who need information at greater depth. But as we heard yesterday, with every piece of new technological kit, not only do you have to buy it up front to begin with, which isn't cheap, but you also have to build it into your annual recurrent budget, the question of maintenance, which is a significant issue. So we were rather cagey about the number of technological bits of kit that we installed. And of course, the whole area is moving very fast, and within a couple of years you're completely out of date and everybody's got handheld monitors and the whole world is changing. The museum also needed a display strategy to help the visitor understand the logic of the collections and of their display. We chose Crossing Cultures, Crossing Time because we wanted to emphasize how societies were linked to one another rather than emphasizing their differences. The idea of global connection is much older than is sometimes realized. We talk about the global village as if it was something new. For centuries, trade, technologies, religions, and frankly, war and empire have drawn continents together. And these links are apparent in our objects. This Buddhist figure wears what is essentially a Roman toga, marrying the sculptural traditions of East and West. And several galleries were devoted to telling the story of these connections, emphasizing how much we had in common with one another rather than the differences. We did have culture-specific galleries. Someone who really wanted to go and see what we had from ancient Greece or Rome, from China or India, they could go and do that. But at the same time, we had galleries devoted to illustrating the links. And even the culture-specific galleries were positioned so that you might move, for example, from ancient Rome to India, because we're well aware of the degree of connection there. Chronologically, the earlier galleries were located lower down the building, with more material, more modern material, located higher up, a bit like an archaeological excavation. And this simple rationale helps the visitor navigate her way around the building. She's got some idea as if she goes up, things are going to get closer to the present day. In effect, we were seeking to change a museum from being curator-centered to visitor-centered. And huge efforts were made to engage the widest possible public directly with the museum. Now, this is not about audience development just to increase visitor numbers, but audience engagement so that visitors can really feel a sense of connection and belonging, actively participating in the life of the museum. The study rooms are open to all, permitting direct access to the entire collection, though demand does mean that an appointment is usually necessary. Not always, but usually. Handling sessions are organised in the galleries, both for those with a special need to handle the material, and also for the casual visitor who gets a kick out of handling objects that are centuries old. The group here are handling coins in the gallery. Musical performances bring to life a historic museum instrument collection. Drawing classes encourage active participation. And of course, school visits are a regular part of our educational program. Our educational team are in close contact with all the local schools and indeed many schools from much farther away who travel surprising distances to visit our collections. And we target particularly specific age groups for various different activities through the school curriculum and indeed, of course, for adult education as well. I'd like to speak briefly about the British Portable Antiquities Scheme, which is, it seems to me, an outstanding example of audience participation. Under the leadership of the British Museum, museums across England are recording archaeological finds reported to them by metal detector users. Now, I realise that different countries have different attitudes to metal detectors, but in Britain we have found cooperating with them much more productive than attempting to prohibit them. Literally thousands of finds are being recorded every year, providing new evidence which transforms our understanding of, for example, the monetization of Anglo-Saxon England. There are many other examples of the things, sort of things we could talk about. Finds are being reported by people who very often left school with no apparent interest in history, but who now personally engage and are fascinated by the past. As well as reporting the finds, they are participating in the preparation of museum exhibitions and contributing data to learned papers. They've discovered a life-enhancing interest and are also contributing importantly to the body of historical knowledge. Seems to me there are real parallels here with alcohol. Metal detectors and alcohol have much in common. Properly used, they are life-enhancing and an enormous benefit to mankind. Of course, they are subject sometimes to abuse. You don't let drunkards drive cars, and you don't let metal detector users onto scheduled archaeological sites. So it needs control, but I genuinely believe that a blanket ban, a blanket prohibition, to use a loaded word, either of alcohol or of metal detectors, actually opens the door to criminal activity in a very alarming and disturbing way, and is counterproductive in terms of the ends that we're trying to achieve. Enough of that. The Ashmolean also regularly organises special events on Friday evenings around some particular theme. It might be photography, it might be fashion. And such evening openings help to bring new visitors into the museum and provide a pleasant social venue. In this way, the museum seeks to become an important part of the life of the community. It's especially important for the university to be able to use the museum as a form of outreach to the city, enabling local people and visitors to engage directly with the university, to get over the town and gown divide. So to sum up, I'd like to identify some key factors in the Ashmolean development. We've involved all grades of the existing museum staff throughout the project. This encourages them to take ownership of the changes taking place and to identify with them. It provides exciting opportunities for career development. Our curators, who knew the collections better than anyone, remained in charge of their exhibitions, guaranteeing the intellectual quality of our displays. However, they also had to collaborate with specialist architects, educators, and designers. Long and painful meetings were necessary as curators learned to express complex ideas more clearly and simply than they were used to, while designers had to accept that aesthetics must compromise with historical truth. We also employed a number of mostly young and temporary staff. They gained valuable experience and several have won permanent positions in museums subsequently. They worked alongside the permanent staff, packing and computerising the collections, for example. And this was much, much cheaper than using specialist art handlers. Now, none of this is easy. In order to open the new museum as quickly as possible, we had to redisplay over 30 new galleries at once. Moreover, those galleries had to be planned on computer since the collections were locked away in store, the exhibition cases were still being built in Belgium, and the galleries were still being constructed. Even when the building and cases were ready, we had just 2 or 3 months to stabilize the environment and to install the objects. Mount making alone was a huge task. Thousands of objects had to have individually custom-made object mounts. And there are many things we could have done better. We should have had a much better database to begin with. This would have been an enormous help in the course of the process, so it's one of the things we should start with. In the same way, we should have had much better off-site storage, which we still don't have in the right quality. We were never able to build a proper archive, store and study room for lack of space. And the archives of our museum, as I say, are particularly important. Of course, they go back to the 17th century and earlier, and this is an important area of study. We never found room, despite our pleadings, for a staff common room, a united staff common room, even though one of the express purposes of the redevelopment was to bring the museum together as a unit rather than to allow the continued and individual individual baronies in the different departments. If time permits later, I can talk about problems with our front door, with the lifts. But if you define success in terms of the accuracy of the exhibitions, together with the public endorsement given by the number of visitors, then this was a project to be proud of. 1.2 million visitors in our first year, and it's now settled down to about 900,000 a year. Almost three times more than we were getting before. With the completion of the rebuilding and the redisplay, strenuous efforts are made to reach the public and deliberately involve them in the life of the museum. A final comment, final piece of advice for anyone facing museum redevelopment. I would urge you, engage with your own museum staff and engage with the public. You have to expect a few extremely tense and difficult years. The process is extremely stressful for everyone, trustees, management, and staff. So be nice to each other, and if you can't be nice, always be polite. Thank you very much.